Welcome to Ring of Fire. I'm Mike Papantonio. Today on Ring of Fire, we'll be discussing the dangers of privatization and outsourcing and how they've brought in new avenues of fraud for corporations. We'll tell you about former AIG CEO Hank Greenberg's lawsuit against the government for helping his company avoid bankruptcy, if you can imagine. And we'll explain how Rand Paul is trying to rebuild the GOP in his own image. And we'll tell you why that's a very scary thought. We have all that and more coming up, but right now, remember, you just stepped into the Ring of Fire.
You can't change Washington from the inside. You can only change it from the outside.
Grand jury secrecy rules.
For political gain.
The press can find out.
That has nothing to do with politics, but yeah, go ahead.
It wouldn't bother me.
Oops.
Following the collapse of 2008, AIG was one of the companies that received a massive government bailout to prevent them from going under. But that wasn't enough for AIG's CEO, Hank Greenberg, and now he's suing the federal government for billions of dollars. Join me now to explain how that lawsuit's working is Howard Nations. Howard, this Greenberg character in AIG, first of all, Greenberg has been in the news almost as long as I can remember with insurance hustles. In Florida, for example, you remember the big hustle where he was trying to hustle people out of insurance claims after the hurricane, for God's sakes. Yeah. And this guy has got a shady, shady background. Every story you look at where there's a Greenberg and AIG involved, it's you go, well, okay, I get it. There's something wrong here. Tell me what the latest story is. It's a remarkable story.
Well, the latest one is that Hank Greenberg is suing the federal government, the taxpayers, if you will, for $40 billion as a result of the $182 billion bailout of AIG, claiming that that bailout to AIG, which saved the company, was unfair to AIG. Let me give you the background on it, Pap. During the credit boom, AIG insured a lot of financial instruments of the Wall Street robber barons, Goldman Sachs and Deutsche Bank and so forth. And they just skipped the basic premise of insurance, that is to keep reserves in case of claims. So they failed to reserve, and in 2008...
Well, let me stop you right there. Yeah. What happens when a company says they can cover something,
right,
like an insurance claim for a hurricane disaster, they're supposed to put money back to cover it, right?
I mean, that's exactly
what... That is the basic parameter for what an insurance company is required to do.
Insurance commissions all over the country require unhypothecated funds to be held back to pay claims.
Okay, so take it from there.
All right, so in 2008, AIG joined the financial services death spiral. They had billions of dollars in losses by their insureds, but they couldn't pay those claims because they hadn't reserved adequately. They had their credit rating cut, they couldn't raise money, and AIG was functionally bankrupt. Their stock value dropped to $5.7 billion, and Bernanke says that they were days away from failure. He also
I saw Daily Beast. I saw the same story covered in Daily Beast, and that Bernanke scenario where Bernanke is saying, were these people basically saying, are they brain dead? Don't they say they're going bankrupt? Don't they see they're going bankrupt? What is it that they don't understand? How bad a shape were they in?
Well, he testified. This trial is ongoing right now, Pap. It's going in D.C. right now. And Bernanke testified that AIG was disconnected from reality. They thought it was a temporary problem when, in fact, they were days away from failing. But they decided that AIG was the classic case of too big to fail, because bankruptcy requires a write-down of losses by all sorts of major corporations because most of the world's financial institutions were doing business with AIG. The write-offs during the crisis, in effect, would have been if AIG collapses, the economy collapses. So the Fed came up with a solution. They bailed out AIG, taxpayer money they paid them, that were paid to the companies that they were their insureds, like Goldman Sachs and Deutsche Bank and others. They paid off the claims that they made against AIG. And then—
What was it, $182 billion?
$182 billion. And in exchange, the Fed demanded interest at 14%, less than bank credit cards. 80% ownership of AIG. So here's what they did. $182 billion bailout, which was secured by $4.7 billion worth of stock. Real ripoff, huh? And now these are the terms that Greenberg is suing over. The Fed basically saved AIG, but and Greenberg's suing him for it.
What is Greenberg? First of all, you know, our friend and associate, David Boies, of all people, is defending, is actually going forward with this lawsuit. God, I hope David's being paid a lot of money by Greenberg. But what is Greenberg actually saying the government did wrong by saving, by taking your money, my money, taxpayer money, and saving the company that was so corrupt and so incompetent that they were on the verge of bankruptcy? What is the argument David Boies or Greenberg would be able to make here?
Well, the argument they're making is that the bailout worked. AIG has lots of assets now. They took $182 billion in taxpayer money. They put it into the company, and by 2012, the company had rebounded. They had paid the interest and principal, and in fact, they had paid $23 billion profit to the taxpayers.
So, Good.
Yeah. So now that everything's, see, Greenberg was removed from AIG in 2005 by with a fraud case by Elliot Spitzer, where they had to pay $1.6 billion in a civil settlement. But now that everything is going fine for AIG, then he comes back. He's still a major shareholder. He comes back now and he says, okay, you should turn that money over to the shareholders, specifically to me. So he's got a $40 billion frivolous lawsuit, and he's got David Boies, who was the attorney for Gore when Supreme Court appointed Bush president. He's got him representing him. David's a great lawyer. But this, here's an interesting thing about this. This is not the first robber baron lawsuit. This is one of more than 20 of this type of lawsuits been filed, Pep. The Freddie Mac and Freddie May.
In other words, let me stop you right there. Yeah. The robber baron lawsuit is all of these thugs who would have gone bankrupt, just like any other mom and pop right. operation. They were incompetent. They were criminal. They were stupid in every regard. They ran their company into the ground. And then we come along as taxpayers and say, oh, now you're different. You're different than a mom and pop operation. So we're going to make sure we can cover your incompetence. So now these same incompetent robber baron thugs are going back to court like Greenberg. You say there's more of them besides Greenberg.
There are. The Chamber of Commerce robber baron theory on this is that taxpayers should provide guaranteed profits. They should ignore manipulation of the markets to ensure those profits. The richest 1% are entitled to unlimited financial privilege in exchange for heavy political contributions. But when the robber baron policies create economic chaos, as they did, the taxpayers should cover their losses. And when the economy recovers, taxpayers should transfer the profits to the robber barons after a successful bailout.
And you're one saying Freddie Mac and Fannie Mae did right. the same thing.
Yes, in 2008 there was a complete collapse. They recklessly incurred hundreds of billions of dollars in mortgage debt. They also were on the verge of bankruptcy. They were too big to fail, and because the banks owned, the robber barons owned hundreds of billions of dollars of their bonds. So the taxpayer bailed them out. They put them into conservatorship. They were taken over by the Federal Housing Finance Agency. And the taxpayers paid $188 billion for them. In exchange, they issued preferred stock to Treasury at 10% dividend, but they were on the verge of default in 2012, so Treasury went in and said, okay, from now on, you're paying all your profits to Treasury. The housing market recovered, and they made profit. To date, they've paid $218 billion on $188 billion worth of loans. So now that it's all flourishing and they're profitable, these hedge fund managers went out and bought the Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac stock. Now they file suit. They're contending the government should turn over ownership to them, but the government should continue to guarantee the debts. this is important. On October 1st, the same day the AIG trial began, Judge Royce Lamberth, who's a Reagan appointee, dismissed that Freddie Mac, Fannie Mae lawsuit on summary judgment. No jury, dismissed it as a matter of law.
Well, okay, so that's something that should be happening. As I listen, I don't see a lot of distinction here in the Greenberg, the big Greenberg lie here. But what I find so amazing as I read this story, think of all the publicity that the McDonald's coffee cup, hot coffee, think of all the publicity that got, which was a drop in the bucket. Here we're talking about hundreds of billions of dollars being hustled from the American taxpayer, and the same criminals are coming back to the well now saying, you gave us hundreds of billions of dollars to save us from our own incompetent ignorance. Now we want you to give us more money. And that's barely a story. But nevertheless, we talked about the McDonald's hot coffee cup case forever as if this was going to change the economics of America. What's your take on that?
Well, my take is that these are exactly the same people. The Chamber of Commerce, the robber barons, and majorly the insurance companies, of which Greenberg was one of the biggest tort reformers there were, that led the charge on tort reform. And these are the same people who slammed the courthouse door on personal injury and wrongful death victims. And now they were screaming for tort reform. They got it activated by their legislative lapdogs. And now they own the court system. They've got it exactly where they want it. Their idea was to keep the courts available only for business litigation. So now they're filing these lawsuits. So if you're a multi-billionaire and you can, the Chamber of Commerce strategy require feds to turn over public assets to private investors without any legitimate basis, litigation costs are nominal when you're a multi-billionaire. So why not take a shot?
Yeah, you're not seeing these stories in the big, I'm telling you, you're not seeing these stories in newspapers and in the big magazines. I love the quote that came from the Daily Beast. This is a story that was really well done in the Daily Beast. And he said, what Hank Greenberg is doing is it's like a man dying of thirst in the desert, and he's suing the guy who rescued him because he was served tap water rather than Evian. And that is just about the attitude of this gray poupon crowd that continues to hustle American taxpayers for every dime they can get while the Justice Department does nothing. Howard, thank you for joining me, okay?
My pleasure, Pap.
There are countless dangers associated with fracking, including water pollution, air pollution, and even earthquakes. And now we can add another fatal consequence to that list, traffic accidents. And I have attorney Tom Crosley here to tell us how the two are related. Tom, it looks like the disaster that's been brought to Texas with the fracking industry just seems to never end. Now we're seeing that the number of deaths from highway fatalities directly related to fracking and the oil industry down there continues to skyrocket. Lay this story out for us just a little bit. It's a crazy story that the media seems to just be ignoring.
Sure, Mike. In San Antonio, we are kind of the epicenter of the fracking boom in Texas. There's three major regions in Texas that have had a significant, and by significant, I mean tenfold increase in heavy truck traffic through their regions. And the reason in San Antonio is the Eagle Ford Shale, which comprises about 23 counties, all in the south of San Antonio, but within about a 40-mile range. And so even before this shale boom, I-35, which is the vertical freeway that runs through Texas, was the heavy truck trafficked freeway in the nation, because it was the gateway to Mexico and the gateway into Interstate 10 heading west and east, and also up to the north. But since 2009, we've had easily a tenfold increase in heavy truck traffic. I'll give you the reasons why. We have we're fracking this shale formation, and each well requires about 2,000 to 4,000 individual truck trips to bring in sand, water, chemicals, tools, and things of that nature. And this is a pretty rural area once you get a few dozen miles outside of the major metropolitan areas in Texas. In fact, the whole state is like that. Once you leave the big cities, you're in the country. And these are small country roads maintained frequently by local units of county government. These roads don't typically have shoulders. They weren't designed to carry heavy vehicle traffic. And what we've done essentially is to inject thousands of heavy truck trips onto these small county roads in these small communities that weren't prepared to handle this oil boom.
Okay, so the way the story to me, Tom, is first of all, the media is covering a little bit about the fact that Texas is burning up to an ember because you don't have enough water out there. I mean, it's amazing when you look at the film footage of lakes that have disappeared, reservoirs that have completely dried up. They look like a desert. We know now that as that's happening, you're taking hundreds of millions of gallons a day, using it for the fracking industry while that very thing happens. We know also that the fracking industry is causing earthquakes down around that ridge between Texas and California. That's clear. They've talked to us about that. You have a governor who doesn't seem to understand that there is something called global climate change. You have a Governor Perry and legislature that seems so damn brain dead that they allow the oil industry to do whatever they want down there. And one of the stories to me that is underreported is you are killing people on the highways. Not only that, you're destroying your highways down there in Texas by having all this truck traffic going back and forth. I don't know, what's the coverage of these stories like out in Texas? Because the national media is not talking about it.
Well, so it takes, unfortunately, a major catastrophe to enter the realm of everyday media in Texas. So what I mean by that in a trucking case is a triple fatality, a case that involves perhaps a van of school children or several well-known community members to be involved in a horrific or catastrophic accident before we get any major coverage. We do get, from time to time, there will be articles or exposés talking about some of the hidden costs of the oil boom. And all of those exposés talk about the increase in fatal accidents. We've had an increase, whereas the rest of the state has had a reduction in fatalities relating to traffic accidents by about 20%. The regions of the state covered by the oil boom have had an increase rather than a reduction by also about 20%. And if you talk to the people in these communities, on the one hand, they are thankful in some ways that they've got this economic boom, but they always ask, at what cost? What is the cost of this so-called progress that we're getting by the increase in oil play in these regions? And the cost for many is that they have, if they're not one of the property owners or they're not directly involved in the economic benefit from the increased drilling, then the cost becomes a dirtier community with more dangerous roadways.
Well, Tom, one thing that I see in the story that I think is an interesting, Houston Chronicle has covered this, and I just think it's remarkable that the police don't really do much about the fact that you have truckers and trucking industries directly related to the oil transport industry that they're scrimping on safety issues. They're pushing deadline issues to where truckers are having to, you know, they're having to work overtime. They're finding that many of these truckers are on speed or some type of amphetamine just so they can stay awake and keep driving. They're not inspecting the trucks that are destroying, literally, and tell me if I'm wrong about this, but what I'm seeing is they're destroying the roads that taxpayers are paying for in Texas. And so you have all of these things taking place, and there doesn't seem to be any will by the governor. Certainly Perry's not going to do anything because he's, you know, just a lump. But your legislature doesn't seem intent on doing anything to try to turn this around. Am I getting that wrong, or is it just my imagination that your legislature has no interest in actually changing any of this?
Well, you've got to remember that there's some pretty powerful lobbies in place that affect our elected representatives. One of the biggest problems we have is just the lack of manpower on the ground to provide all the inspections and enforce all the rules. Because if you have the same number of inspectors, but you increase the truck traffic by a factor of 10, there's just no way for them to get to all those trucks or do all those inspections.
Tom, do you from time to time see stories about the fact that the fracking water that's being dispersed around that area is actually infecting the aquifer, the drinking aquifer, like we're seeing up in Pennsylvania or other parts of the country where your children are drinking aquifer water that's been poisoned by fracking chemicals? Do you see those stories from time to time?
We do see those stories from time to time, and I have not yet seen that enter our major aquifer that controls San Antonio, which is pretty well regulated, but I do see it. We have a lot of rural landowners that rely on water wells on their property as their major source of water supply. And so we see those stories from time to time relating to those rural landowners.
Let me ask you this, Tom. We see stories, we also see stories every now and then. You'll see a story about a rancher is having to sell all of his cattle because there simply is not enough feed there. Everything has turned to desert. They have to get rid of their cattle. But at the same time that they're having to get rid of their cattle because of a lack of water, you are still supplying the oil industry with millions and millions of gallons of water. Is that accurate? Or, I mean, you drive through that area. Are there parts that look like desert wasteland at this point?
Oh, absolutely. I mean, it's no secret that we are in a severe five-year drought in this part of Texas. In fact, most of the state of Texas, certainly the western half and southern portion. And it's a problem in that it's market forces are at play that oil companies are able to divert water resources that would otherwise go to farming and ranching and put them instead to developing the energy play.
Does there seem to be any recognition, Tom, that there is something called global climate change that probably more than likely every scientist in the world that's credible says is at play here? Does that seem to be just even a talking point out in Texas right now?
Not even. I mean, we are in Texas and we are in the epicenter of this oil boom. And nobody's talking about global warming on a large scale, at least in my community.
Yeah. Tom, thank you for joining us. I hope you can have an impact. You certainly are an effective lawyer down there. It sounds like some very good lawyering has to take place to change the way that oil companies are just doing irreparable harm to your citizens. So thank you for joining me, okay?
You're welcome, Mike.
Corporations are always looking for new avenues where they can defraud customers. One of the newest and largest industries where fraud's becoming common is the construction industry. I have attorney Mike Burg with me to tell us how that's happening. Mike, you know, I'm glad you can talk about this topic that we just don't hear enough about. You are one of the country's leading experts in construction litigation, defect litigation, and most people don't even know what that is. They live, say, in a condominium or they live in an apartment that has all types of structural problems. It may be pollution problems. It may be construction defect. It could be a whole host of problems that cause illness, causes death in many instances. And they never even hear that, gee, I can do something about this because I have defective, I'm living in a on a defective site. Tell us what defective site litigation is all about.
Well, you know what? One of the problems we have here is that it's been worsened by the lack of unions. We used to have master plumbers, master electricians, people, master bricklayers, masonries, people who knew what they were doing. Those people are gone. Today, in the multifamily condos, in the single family homes, you have people who are untrained. You have workers who do not know the proper way to make sure that these homes or these condos or multifamily units are put up correctly. And it goes from, you know, water is one of the biggest problems you have is either you may have an envelope that's bad on the outside of a building, or you may have problems with the soils in which you may have, like we have here in Colorado, bentonite, or you may have soils in which houses shouldn't be built on. We see that in California. We see
okay,
that in
can,
lots
can
of
I
states.
Stop you right there? In
Absolutely.
Other words, the reason that happens is because along with a lack of union oversight, in other words, a union builder would be required to say, do we have the proper papers here? Have we looked at the right regulations? But what you're finding is as I follow your litigation here, is you're finding companies that are willing to build anywhere without any type of regulatory oversight, and they're building on contaminated, first of all, building on contaminated soil. They're using secondary construction material that's causing all types of off-gassing inside the house, causes molding pollution inside the house. You have, and then add to that, the workers that are putting it up are no longer union. They're simply, let's grab whoever we can and have them build this house. Is that kind of, is that sum up what you're...
That's a great summary, Mike. What I think people have to understand is that these builders are going to build it and developers as cheaply as possible. We've seen, to give you examples, where they refuse to put rebar, which is required, into the brick. We've seen brick walls fail, and we go in there and we find there's no rebar in there. We've seen homes and condos in which there are structural defects, in which there's going to be cave-ins. We had one in a multi-million dollar house where they failed to put up the structure in such a way that it would cause the roof from not caving in. And we had to knock down the walls to get in there to see the failure there. We've seen homes sliding off sides of hills because they haven't done the proper soil compactment and they haven't put in the foundation properly. It runs the full gamut.
Is it a new trend, Mike? Is it a new trend more that we're seeing, like say maybe in the last 15 years?
From what, yes.
When I listen to your people talk about it, it sounds to me like it's a trend that has really developed over the last 15 years in a serious kind of way.
It has, and I think it has to do with the developers and builders trying to build. Remember when we had the housing boom and the condo boom, they were using people, they were slapping these things up as quickly as they could. They were using labor, many of which were illegals from Mexico who came in here, wanted to do work, and they began to try to figure out, well, how do I work on a construction site with very little training? And I think one of the biggest problems homeowners and people who live in a condo building think is that the local guy who has to come out and approve it before
the inspector,
you can get, yeah. Inspector, yeah, who by the way is not really inspecting. He's not looking at it. He's basically just signing it off. He doesn't really care enough. And quite frankly, sometimes there's corruption in which the inspector is involved in, where the builder is making sure that everything gets approved by the inspector.
How bad, what are some of the worst scenarios that you've seen? I mean, I know you've talked about, I've heard you talk about the risk of fire, the risk of poisoning by way of mold that sets up in the sidewalls or up in the ceiling. I've heard you talk about water contamination that people don't even know about that contaminates all the way into the foundation, and people live with off-gassing from that contaminated foundation. Just a whole host of things that you go, gee whiz, it's not the kind of thing you think about living in your home or your apartment.
Well, yeah, all those things you mentioned are all true. One of the problems you may have is you may not have a fire prevention system that actually works. We had one case, this is an amazing case, and it was in an apartment building in which they didn't do water testing on the fire prevention system, your sprinkler system. And so what ended up happening there was, and again, the fire chief, this was in Kansas, allowed it to go through, and they did air testing. Well, ultimately, what happened was they had a fire that was occurring, a small fire. There were leaks everywhere. So not only did you have a problem with the fire, but the water itself, because it leaked throughout the system, damaged units after units after units.
In other words, we're talking about a multi-unit building here. So somebody has a unit on the third floor. They think, I'm safe. But somebody else on the fourth floor, the fifth floor, has a defective unit. It destroys that unit on the third floor, too.
Absolutely. But here, the entire system hadn't been tested. One of the worst things we've ever seen. We've also seen condos where basically you have movement. Everyone's house moves because of the soils. And here we have them where you can't even get through the doors. They go sideways, and you have collapses. We've had soundproofing problems where you could hear, unfortunately, people going to the bathroom in the unit next door because they hadn't complied with the building code with regard to the soundproofing. This is a serious problem, and it's a problem that is expanding and continuing to get worse as the builders continue to build. And they're trying to stop it in the legislature. They're trying to stop us from helping homeowners. This is the biggest investment you'll make, is buying your home or your condo. And there's legislative action where the builders are trying to keep you from being able to sue these builders and developers.
And just like everything else, we have the PAC money coming in. We have them greasing the palms of legislators and regulators and inspectors of every kind who are willing to do and say whatever the hell they want for the right amount of money. If you're in a condo, and you're surrounded by other condos and you have a problem like you're talking about, what do you do about it? How do you ever get any real change for the entire facility?
Well, first of all, you need to make sure that your homeowner association is representative of the people that own. One of the things that you need to look at that. People don't even think about it, because the home builders are now being, and these big condo project builders, the developers are trying to keep control of the homeowner association even after they're gone, so they can prevent the homeowners themselves from bringing in action. Normally, it's brought in through the association. So number one, if you have a problem and that problem's in your unit, it's probably in all the units, because they generally don't make this one mistake. And so you got to talk to your neighbors, and you got to get to your homeowners association, and then you got to bring in a law firm like ours or a law firm like yours who knows what they're doing in this, because it takes experts. It takes a firm that is financially in a position where they can hire the best experts, because again, you're going to have to fight these giant builders and their insurance companies to make sure that they do the repairs properly, so you get what you paid for in your condo or in your home.
All right, Mike Burg, thank you for joining us. I hope people can. I hope we have viewers that aren't simply living in this horrible situation without saying and saying there's nothing I can do. There is something you can do, and that is to fight back. Thank you for joining me.
Thank you, Mike.
It's no secret that Wall Street banks are breeding grounds for corruption, but a new series of tapes that surfaced recently have given us an inside view of just how deceitful some of those banks truly are. Joining me now to talk about that is Peter Mougey. Peter, I don't know anybody who keeps up more because with what's going on the Wall Street, Goldman Sachs kind of scandals. Thank goodness you're out there keeping up with all this and actually suing these thugs when they need to be sued. There were some real revelations that came out in these Goldman Sachs tapes. I mean, people almost can't believe that this kind of conduct goes on Wall Street and nobody goes to jail. Talk about it. Just lay the story out for me, if you would.
I tell you what, Pap, it's just another example in a long list of just this coziness between the regulators, whether it be the feds, whether it be the banks, you name it. It's this cozy relationship you have. And here's what I think the problem is, Pap, and I call it a revolving door, or it's agency recapture. And Eric Holder is another good example too with his law firm. And here's what you got. Essentially, you've got these regulators that work at these law firms, and they come up in this practice of very cozy where they represent the bank. So it's like Covington Burlington, Eric Holder's old shop. Whether it be the Goldman Sachs story, it doesn't matter. And essentially, they're representing the banks. They're getting the banks the best deal they can. Every time they get into regulatory trouble, the amount of money is absolutely huge. So they're representing the banks, and then they get called by the regulators. And the regulators say, why don't you come to the SEC? Why don't you come to the Fed? It doesn't matter.
You mean, why don't you go to work?
Why don't you go to work for them? Yeah, exactly. So why don't you come to work for us? You do your stint, whether it be 2 years, 4 years, 6 years, whatever. You stay at the regulatory body or the governmental agency like the SEC, or Eric Holder is the AG. And then you go back to the private practice side. And these regulators know, and that's what you're seeing in the culture with the Goldman Sachs story. The regulators know that you can't get quite too aggressive with the banks. You can't piss them off too much, because if you do, when you go back to the private sector side, you're not going to have that cozy relationship and get the regular amount of business with these million and million dollar representations that they are from these private practice side.
So Peter, let me ask you something. You were president of the largest organization in America that handles securities claims against people like Goldman Sachs. And I want to ask you something. When you tried, at any point, when you try to get help from the SEC or the Fed or the people who are supposed to be monitoring and regulating Wall Street, describe what happens with the average claimant out there.
I'll tell you what, it's easy. The amount of work you get from the Fed side is absolutely zero, Pap. It's a goose egg. You don't get any help from them. They're always a day late. They're a dollar short. They're years and years behind the scheme. They're years and years behind the fraud. The banks have already made billions of dollars based on the problem. And the federal regulators show up a day late and a dollar short. You don't get any help from them. Now, the state regulators are a little bit different theme. That body does a heck of a lot more work and a lot more good than the Fed side. But the federal side, the SEC, the federal regulators, they're always behind the eight ball.
Where did the Fed and the SEC come up with this harebrained idea that a bunch of criminals, I mean, half these people that are involved in these scandals should be in prison? I mean, I know you would agree with me on that. I've seen it firsthand. I've seen the work that you do, where you come back and you say, this is what happened, and I'm always asking you, why aren't they thrown in prison? But the point is, where did they get this harebrained idea that Wall Street is going to regulate itself? Honestly, where in the hell does that come from?
It doesn't work. I don't know how many different examples we need. They call them SROs, self-regulatory organizations. It's like FINRA. They create FINRA. FINRA is this self-regulatory organization that's supposed to oversee itself. Pap, it just doesn't work. It's never worked. It's not going to work. The compensation system, the agency recapture problems, the self-regulation, it doesn't work. Greed overtakes the moral compass. It just, whatever lines their pockets, whatever puts their interest first, their pocketbooks ahead of the bottom line, that's what rules, that's what governs. Again and again and again and again, it's not working. The system set up is not working. We have this epic once a century market meltdown every 10 years. And the mainstream.
And your prediction, I've heard you talk, you think it's coming again.
It's got to be. Right now, the bond markets are jittering. We have places like Puerto Rico, which is just another complete debacle as far as the conflicts of interest. UBS.
Okay, let me ask you something. You are the lead lawyer, one of the lead lawyers in the Puerto Rico scandal. The big heist that Wall Street got involved stealing from people in Puerto Rico. Explain that, and then explain how much help you've gotten from the government, the United States government, or the Justice Department, trying to do anything about this.
Well, we just filed 150 claims, and what you've got essentially, let me give you lay it out, because this is a perfect example of just how incestuous these relationships are. UBS, Puerto Rico, is the investment consultant to their pension system. So they're getting money, getting paid as the investment consultant. The retirement system in Puerto Rico is upside down. It's an inverted pyramid, meaning they have just a tiny amount of workers paying all the retirees. It's upside down. UBS recommends to this upside down, broken retirement system, they issue bonds. UBS is the underwriter on billions of dollars of these bonds. They make almost $30 million in 2009 off the issuance. The bonds have zero market value. They can't sell them. Everybody knows the retirement system's broken. The chances of getting paid are zero. So UBS makes their money as the investment consultant. They make their $30 million as the underwriter. Well, what do they do, Pat? Because they can't sell them, they create closed-end funds, or the closed-end funds, mutual funds that they have open. They take these bond funds and stuff them in their own closed-end bond funds and sell them to their own customers. So then they make money.
Basically, are they hiding them? Basically, you know, nobody knows about it. Let's hide it. Let's not disclose the conflict of interest we have.
The conflicts of interest. I mean, the poor guy that gets the Puerto Rican fisherman, the taxi cab driver, Main Street Pap that buys this stuff, they don't know about all these conflicts and different hats that UBS wears. UBS is driven to the bottom line. They don't care about the end user. They don't care about Main Street. All of these conflicts, Pap, and the regulators have just let it go. The regulators are non-existent. There's nothing from the regulators. We've done more investigation than the regulators have, and you're talking about an island with just a few million people on it. We're looking at portfolio after portfolio after portfolio. They don't own this much in their portfolios. UBS has filled their portfolios with this crap and sold it to them, and the fishermen, the taxi cab driver, the guy that takes your bags, all of their retirements are down 60, 70%.
What has the government done to try to help the private lawyers? Zero.
No, this is zero. Okay. Absolutely nothing. They're always behind us. They're always behind us. They're always coming out after we do our work. We're always the ones driving the litigation, not the other way around. We're always out in front. I sometimes just wish they'd stay out of the way, because when they do issue orders or they do issue settlements, they don't mean anything. They let the banks get off with this. We don't admit that we did any wrongdoing. That gets thrown around during the course. They don't do anything.
One thing I've seen you do when you close, I mean, really some of the biggest projects in America against Wall Street. I've watched you, and one thing you always argue is, why in the hell isn't there a criminal side to them? These companies pay money. They pay $50 billion and nobody goes to jail. And your position has always been, you can't change the culture until you throw these thieves like the UBS thugs that you're talking about in prison.
Let me take even a step back. The problem is that the way these guys are compensated, the officers, the directors, the big hitters at these firms are paid based on the increase in stock price or the bottom line. They don't have any downside. So it's swing for the fences, take the biggest risk you can, because when they hit, it all goes in their pocket. But the downside, the shareholders take. So the shareholders eat the downside. The officers get the upside with the stock upswings. And so we got to change the compensation
system.
And nobody
goes to jail. Nobody goes to jail.
And that's just where I was going. At the end of the day, no individuals are held accountable. Fining these companies a gazillion dollars, who pays it?
Right.
Not the guy in charge who did the wrongdoing. The guy who pays it is the shareholder. You and I pay it. We're the shareholders. We pay it.
Peter Mougey, everybody ought to be glad that people out there like you, because you're really like the last line in the sand. Thank you for joining me.
Thanks for having me.
The Republican Party has so many problems that it's amazing they can even win elections, but Rand Paul believes he can fix the party. I have Adele Stan from the American Prospect to talk about that. Adele, Rand Paul, I mean, I don't even know what to think. It seems like every millennial out there believes that he is the new Barry Goldwater, and that's pretty scary to me. This is, by the way, just a great story that you did for the American Prospect on Rand Paul's millennial quest. Lay it out for us. How do you see Rand Paul?
Well, here's the thing, Mike, it's just amazing to me that, Rand Paul he's really clever in a lot of ways, even though he says some crazy stuff, right? Because when he's talking to millennials, he knows that the Republican Party as it exists now is dying, right? It's old white people. So what he needs is some young people to come in. And so he emphasizes this, the libertarian angle of his message, right? Which he talks about civil liberties, he talks about drones, he talks about reforming marijuana laws and laws that are discriminatory in the justice system about different kinds of drugs. He's anti-war. But like, none of those things are exactly quite true, right?
Yeah.
He's a stage rights guy.
Okay, so what we have is this character that says all the right thing, but when you start drilling down onto what he's really saying, there's a story behind the story. He really is not. If you take the best equation that I've heard, obviously, is the Barry Goldwater equation, and that is that all of a sudden Barry Goldwater was the great organizer, and he was certainly the great organizer on college campuses. He got young people excited about this idea of new Nazi neocon Republican notions. And so he was, I don't know how else to describe it. If you go back and look at some of the stuff he talked about, it's just remarkable. But kids on campuses, he sounded different. And he created the new neoconservative movement in America. And so your concern about Rand Paul seems to be very similar.
Yeah, well, when you look at how Rand Paul is organizing, it really seems to be very much out of the Barry Goldwater playbook, which is what my piece in the American Prospect basically lays out. What Barry Goldwater did, and you have to remember, he was an insurgent candidate. He was a long shot candidate. He was not, the guy that was by any means anointed by the Republican establishment of the day. But what he did was, he, first of all, his partisans infiltrated the young Republicans clubs on campuses throughout the nation. And they basically took over those clubs. Then they also also started their own, there was a breakaway movement from the Young Republicans that was even more specific to Goldwater, which was the Young Americans for Freedom. And once you organized all these kids and managed to get them seated as delegates at the convention and just organizing for people to turn out in the polls, Barry Goldwater was able to pull it off. So Rand Paul, now you got to remember, his dad has been organizing for years in his quixotic presidential campaigns, and he does so through an organization called Young Americans for Liberty, which they claim to have outposts on 527 college campuses across the nation. Now, those numbers may be slightly inflated. It's hard to know. But you see that is what Rand Paul is doing. In fact, very significantly, I think a week or two ago, he was at University of South Carolina, and South Carolina being an early primary state. And he was, had his pictures taken with a lot of toe-headed kids. But, he talks a big game about racial relations. He talks a big game about getting millennials in. But when you drill down and look at the millennials that he's likely to bring in, it's a very white contingent.
Well, it's amazing to me when you go back, and I know you've done this. I've certainly done it. I've taken a look at what the splinter groups that came out of the Barry Goldwater years, what did they look like? And when I say it was Berlin 36, 1936, I really am not exaggerating. I mean, you look at, it's not just anti-race. It's not just anti-social safety net. It's not let's bomb the hell out of everybody in the world that gets in our way. That was basically the platform of the splinter groups that came out of the Barry Goldwater years. Now, what do we expect out of the Rand Paul years? What are these millennials, what is it that they want to hear? What comes out as the splinter group from Rand Paul?
You're quite right about the Goldwater campaign in terms of, all the different groups that came out of it. If you look at it, really the whole of what we came to know as the new right came out of the Goldwater campaign, whether it was the religious right or the free marketeers or whatever. If you look at Rand Paul's campaign, I think what you're going to see is a new hybrid, a new hybridization of that old ideology, Mike, which, will have the free marketeer stuff, it will have language about civil liberties and freedom, but it will also have that states' rights basis. And if you look at who loves Rand Paul, it's a lot of young white guys, right? And that's because his ideology, in the end, only empowers young white guys. I mean, he's completely anti-choice. He opposes the public accommodation section of the Civil Rights Act. But he's doing these minority outreach things, these events that I think are really designed to ameliorate, to make him more palatable to a white millennial.
Well, he's showing up at things like CPAC and the various Republican crazy talk sessions, and he's a rock star. I mean, if you think about it, he's a rock star. He has the same kind of numbers as Chris Christie, ahead of Ted Cruz. I mean, he is the new rock star out there for millennials, and it's only because, as you point out, it's not all millennials, but if you take a look at it, he has appeal from the kids that say, well, let's legalize marijuana everywhere. We don't want to be involved in any wars. We don't want any regulations. We want to do what the hell we want. And it's something that looks almost akin to anarchy. That is Rand Paul's appeal to that kind of narrow group of young millennial white kids. But I mean, that's kind of what I see with it.
I'm worried that it's not that narrow, because what I feel, Mike, is that the Democrats have failed to step in and embrace some of the issues on which Rand Paul is correct, right?
Well, how about Ferguson? You pointed out in your article that where the hell was Hillary? You had Hillary Clinton a sound asleep, while you got to let a guy like Rand Paul look like he's claiming the high ground on something like Ferguson. How does that happen, except for what you're explaining? The Democrats are dead at the wheel again.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, the Democrats have been, kind of mealy-mouthed on the NSA stuff. They've been, unwilling to take on the president in terms of getting involved in more foreign intervention. And particularly particularly with this criminal justice reform, Democrats may be working on it, you know, but they're not stepping up and making the noise about it, because I think Democrats are just sort of terrified of being, you know, classified as either weak or cowards or whatever. Rand Paul doesn't have that issue. He sees how the numbers play out for him, and he knows that if he's going to have to peel off little pieces of different constituencies in order to win. You know, he's not going to win all of the evangelicals. He's not going to win all the millennials. He's going to have to peel off different slices of these constituencies, put them together in a new way in order to win.
Yeah, you explain in your article that he's going to cobble together the Silicon Valley donors, the anti-tax Republicans, the privacy-driven millennials, and it makes perfect sense because if you watch what he's doing all along the way, he seems to be accomplishing that. Now, one quick question about 15 seconds. Is he a real contender in the Republican
Indeed, primaries? He is. He's right now running neck and neck with the establishment candidates, and I think he's going to give them a run for their money unless he makes a really totally ridiculous gaffe.
Will you see establishment Republicans going after him aggressively?
Yes, absolutely. I think that, you know, he's going to be getting hit from all sides, from the establishment Republicans and from the Democrats. But it may take the establishment Republicans a few minutes to step up to hit him hard because they're just figuring out what to do with him.
Well, to figure out that they're changing the entire nature of that he's changing the entire nature of their already failed party. Adele, thank you for joining us. Great article in the American Prospect, Rand Paul's Millennial Quest. It is very well done. Thanks for joining me.
Thanks so much for having me.
Republicans always love to tell us the private industry can do better than the government. This goes for education, prisons, health care, and even Social Security. But the sad truth is privatized industries are ripe with fraud. And I have David Haynes with me now to explain how that's happened. David, tell us about the privatization train wreck that's taking place in really everywhere there's a Republican governor. I mean, if you just look across the board, everywhere, every state, whether it's Michigan, Pennsylvania, Wisconsin, Florida, you name it, if they have a Republican governor, those governors have tried to privatize virtually everything, and it is an absolute train wreck for the taxpayers in that state. Talk about it.
You're right. Kansas, Ohio, I mean, you look at some of the far-right governors in our states around the country, and this is what's being done under the guise, of course, of reducing government and supposedly saving taxpayers money. But in reality, what it is this is a huge cash giveaway to some of their biggest political donors under the guise of privatizing and streamlining government. What we have is, in fact, has cost taxpayers in our government millions, if not billions of dollars. And there's been terrible fraud and other problems have run amok, and it is not serving the people well at all.
Okay, so give us some examples. I mean, I can't help but focus on what's happened with Aramark. Talk about the Aramark story up in Michigan to really give the people an understanding of what a disaster this ALEC, you know, of course, ALEC are the people that pushed this state by state. Put it in perspective for us.
Yeah, and that's right. When you look to the source and you look at ALEC and who this really is, these are the large corporations that are drafting this model legislation, and they're going around the country to serve their members, which are the corporations. And so Aramark is one example of this in Michigan, where they privatized the food industry, essentially, in the prison system. And what we have is terrible food service. They had rotten food and so forth being served. They had no employee control. What happens is the business comes in and hires folks at minimum wage and takes away decent government jobs for hardworking families, comes in, and in order to increase their profit, they pay folks as little as possible. And so we had a number of problems with employees. Even one Aramark employee was charged in a murder for hire plot to try to hire another prisoner to off yet another prisoner they'd come into contact with. So just a terrible
David,
number of
what
problems.
Other states do you see this kind of thing happening? I mean, where they're privatizing everything from water services to state liquor sales?
Well, we have it all across the country. In Ohio, with Governor Kasich is doing this, Governor Corbett in Pennsylvania, Governor Snyder in Michigan with the Aramark situation of the food delivery service. They are in the prisons where they're serving maggots and rotten meat and other food, yet they continue to be awarded the contract. Governor Scott, of course, in Florida was calling for certain reforms, and he's just basically turned over contracts to his cronies. Kansas is one of the worst violators as well, as well as Governor Walker, of course, in Wisconsin, which has been a hotly contested and watched state on these issues. So every government program which is involves significant funding. The Republicans are trying to plunder it for their personal gain and hand out corporate contracts to their cronies, whether it's the schools through charter schools or online mandatory education, turning over the prison systems and the food services there, the medical system, of course, and healthcare and Medicaid. This is one of the largest financial areas that the Republicans and these corporate interests can plunder, essentially. And all these are the ALEC donors. You know, water services, as we discussed, they're trying to liquor sales, going to privatize liquor sales, Sheets and these other gas stations. They all are there contributing millions of dollars. And why? Because they're turning around and they're getting the contracts. And the fact is that this delivery of government services is not being done more efficiently than corporations. It's being done for the cheapest dollar, the cheapest wage that they can. And the corporate owners are the ones that are reaping huge windfall. And many, many times over, they're reaping the benefit of their corporate contributions to these Republican
governors.
And it's
so bad that in Kansas, for example, Sam Brownback, they actually downgraded by the S&P because of the contracts that they were handing out to be privatized. They got such miserable results. You had Pennsylvania, where you had the school funding was going to be the top of the line. This is the guy, Tom Corbett, said, yeah, school funding is most important. He ends up giving multi-millions of dollars to private education, takes it away from public education. It is the ALEC plan taking place state by state, everywhere there's a Republican governor. And if you have a Republican governor plus a Republican legislature, you better just hold on to your wallet, taxpayers, because it's getting ready to go to private corporations. David, thank you for joining me, okay?
Thank you, Pat.
That's it for this week's Ring of Fire. You can keep up with us throughout the week online at ringoffireradio.com or on a Twitter at Ring of Fire Radio and on Facebook. I'm Mike Papantonio. We'll see you next week right here on Ring of Fire.